Hello, Malty Manx, Master Mitchell Mentor. MMM. There's three more mentioned words, but I don't want them to get too convoluted because people are going to get fed up waiting for the review. So I've abbreviated the malt mention. Richard L. Wilson, you provided the malt mention. I hope you haven't taken offence, but I've slightly squished your malt mention. And there is a reason. I want to get stuck into this review of a summery single malt. This is a style of single malt whiskey which has fresh fruits and not much in the way of peat. So it's reminiscent of summer days and soft seasons. And here it is. It's an independent bottling of Glenlivet. Yep, that's what it is. Glenlivet, 12-year-old, bottled at 46%, natural colour and unchill filtered because it says so. And this label from Signatory Vintage independent bottlers gives a reason why it's unchill filtered. I shall read out that reason for you, because do you know what, malt mates? I know you're interested. Due to no chill filtration, this whiskey may turn cloudy when stored in a cool place. It is both more full-bodied and full-flavoured. And that, malt mates, is the label with the information. All information, very little flannel. All whiskey drinkers who take their hobby seriously will graduate to bottles like these. Have a look at the colour. You can see the haze in it, actually. Natural colour. Three glasses, one at a time. Pour a wee dram for the anoraks amongst you who want to know specifically which version of Glenlivet 12-year-old that I'm reviewing from Signatory, because they do quite a lot of bottlings. It is cask number, so it's a single cask. It's a single cask whisky, 900279, distilled in 2007, bottled in 2019, a first fill sherry butt. Now what that tells us, useful information, because a butt is the bigger, it's the biggest size really, of oak cask that can be used. It's roughly about 600 to 650 litres. There are some other huge casks out there, but it's mainly butts, being practical about it. But they're not exceeding 700 litres. That's important. But being big barrels, it takes longer because of the content to surface ratio. It takes longer to mature the spirit, and it matures in a slightly different way depending on location. But you will generally find that whatever the warehouse, the butt is always stored on the ground floor because it's too heavy even for the forklifts. Right, what a good start. Now, this is a little bit more of a convoluted review for the simple reason that back in Ralfy Review 814, which was pre-pandemic review, it was back in February 2020. I reviewed this 12-year-old official bottling, double oak it was called, bourbon oak. And I really, really enjoyed it. And I think some folk were quite surprised that I gave it such a good mark. So you can go and have a look at that review if you haven't already seen it, because what I'm gonna do is compare and contrast these two bottles. One is an official bottling, chill filtered, just a little bit of caramel in it, perhaps. We don't know. They don't say. And it's bottled at 40%, so the absolute minimum. Although if you're in the US, of course, you get extra 3% because you're more valued customers. It's as simple as that. So here's the official bottling, which I rated quite highly because of the nose. The nose is just excellent. The flavour was slightly less so, but still, it was impressive enough. And I am not one of these reviewers where I go and see what other people have reviewed marked a whiskey and then kind of average it out within a mark or two so there's consensus. Bollocks. Every reviewer who is providing a mark as an assessment for any spirit should call it exactly as they see it. If it doesn't fit in with the mean average, so sad, too bad, never mind. I'm talking about my experience with this whiskey, not anybody else's. So, a big thank you, while these open up a little bit, to Jan Muse, who said, if you want to take it up a notch and you can find a bottle, you should try the Glenlivet's 12-year-old 2007 bottle by Signatory. Oh, funny that. So, thank you, Jan. Really good idea and something I've not actually done before. So, here we go. Nose. Quite oak resinous. It's got that oak aromatic. It's not immediately recognisable as Glenlivet. It's certainly not peated. It's fresh fruity. Pineapples, apples, some pear, a little bit of banana, touch of apricot in the background. But this is quite resinous, oak resinous. First taste. Oh, you're getting a big impact from the 46%, delivering a very sherbety, sharp, slightly sawdust, resinous wood resin, fresh fruit style of single malt. But I can tell you right now, neat on the nose, it is not as good as the official bottling, but on the flavour, it's just busier, it's more active, there's just more going on. It was the flavour, really, that let the official bottling down slightly, and that wouldn't have happened even at 43, but ideally at 46%. There you go. Time to add a drop of water. I'm going to add a little drop of water to the official bottling, and I'm going to add a half a teaspoon. So I added about 1 milligram of water to the official bottling Glenlivet, 40%, and 4 milligrams to the independent bottling. It's both same age, same single malt, but literally two different bottling philosophies. I'll come back to the, in fact, I'm going to nose the official bottling at the moment, because it will allow me to make more of a comparison. It's more subtle on the nose, but it's more complex as well. The signature, the still signature, is simply more expressive. It's got a little bit of confectionery and icing sugar about it. It's a delightful nose. Fresh, unassuming, honest. But when you taste it, tangy, sweet and sour, controlled, the events controlled, the taste is, it's more of a sensation experience than a flavour experience. The flavours in the official bottling are secondary to the sensation, the sweet and the sour, slight bitterness and the sort of resinous note of it. In the independent bottling, which has been reduced now to make them on the more of an equal footing, but of course when you add water to higher strength whiskey, it takes time for the whiskey alcohol to release the flavours. So it's not like it's diluted and it's just tasting dilute. In fact, you can add water to a higher strength whiskey and it will actually taste stronger after you've added the water. That's not unusual. Little bit of Scotch mist appearing here, malt mates. We do approve. Whole different level of richness. It's got a light, slightly yeasty note and a kind of grain rich, almost oat biscuit type flavour. The expressiveness coming off the still is not as prominent on the nose in the independent bottling compared to the official bottling, but the actual range of arrival and development and the substance of the finish is definitely more prominent. It's much more of a tangible event in the independent bottling of Glenlivet. Now, I'm always happy to recommend Signatory. You've got to be careful what you buy, because in my opinion, they bottle some less impressive whiskies. However, the price that they charge is actually certainly in the British Isles. If you're buying in the British Isles, I can't speak for anywhere else, because then the importers are involved and etc. And shop retailers are going to say, with Scotch whiskey, we can get more for that because it's more obscure. So I can't answer for prices elsewhere out with the British Isles, but certainly it's quite competitively priced, particularly for the caliber and the integrity of the bottling that's going on here. And if you have a standard bottling of any single malt, I highly recommend that you look out for an independent, familiar, similar version and experiment for yourself with the experience, because you're going to learn such a lot. Now, what I'm going to do now is I'm going to tie up and focus now in the malt mark for the Signatory vintage version of Glenlivet. Creamy, slightly syrupy now. Still resinous, quite a lot of wood flavour in it, fresh wood flavour, but pleasantly so. Fantastic arrival. Very summery. Unassuming. A simple, complex malt that is just a delight. The range of flavours, as the event goes from the arrival to the development into the finish, you get that little bit of pineapple, bananas and pineapple, some little bit of tropical fruit, not much. It's more apples and sultanas, a little bit of pear. And into the finish, you've got some fresh brewed tea, but not much in the way of tannins, very little in the way of tannins. A nice, fresh, clean, crisp, a lovely, crisp, aromatic malt. A really nice version of Glenlivet. Glenlivet tends to be relegated in people's radars because it's not the big name, big reputation like Macallan or Lagavulin or Springbank even. And Bowmore, another good example. But do you know what? These more jobbing single malt whiskies, pedestrian single malt whiskies, they're well worth exploring in just a little bit more detail and with a little bit more patience, malt mates, because you're going to be pleasantly surprised. And bear in mind, Glenlivet is the single malt that got its reputation first, way back in the days. I'm going to give this 88 out of 100. That is a malt mark. Now, where's my malt mark card? It's tucked under a little prompty sheet here. It's a malt mark. And it's an integrity bottling. I'm just going to mention it. What happens next? Well, what would you do with your whiskey Bothy, where you are malt mates, if you had a 12-year-old official bottling and a 12-year-old independent bottling, same malt, same age, more or less, but from different bottlers, seeking to deliver different experiences? Well, this is the reason for the first glass. Firstly, for the third glass, because what you do is you add half and half. You now have a third glass of 12-year-old Glenlivet single malt, which nobody else in the world has, only you, in your malt moment, Bothy culture. Absolutely, because you've created it yourself. That makes you, malt mates, a blender. And this is one of the easiest ways to do it. You start off half and half, and then next time you do one third, two thirds, and then two thirds, one thirds. And then you, next time you'd have an official bottling with a drop of independent in it, and you think, my goodness, how could so little make such a huge difference? And then you do the reverse and you get the same result. And every time you're getting a different, utterly unique, bespoke, one-off, single malt that you've created yourself. Now that's got to be good. You can't really do it with American bourbon because there just isn't the independent bottlers. You can't do it, well, you can now do it with rum more because there's more independent rum bottlers in the scene. Thank goodness, because they're the actual ones that present and package the calibre of rum rather than more pirates and palm trees. They have their place, but not too much. So, let's nose this. It's different from what I would expect to be the summary of the two noses put together. It's richer. Slightly waxy even. Together, they've done that wonderful thing. They've become more than the sum of their parts. I would give this 90 out of 100. So the finish, you see, the finish is, it seems simple, but it grows complex. There's little almond oil, little bit of wax in the finish, little bit of lemon juice, hint of lemon juice, and pickled pineapple. You can find that in some restaurants. I'm Ralphie, this is the Bothy. I am the Malt Moment Mentor. I'm here to provide you with malt moments. I hope you have enjoyed this. I hope you will return for Ralphie Review 825 Extras, in which I'll be continuing to expand on the theme and the motivation that you should have for blending your own. Join me. Now, where's my clicker? Here it is. I'm getting the hang of this, by the way. I changed the battery twice and I've discovered that if I hold it a certain angle, right, just down about here, if I hold it this angle, but not over here, no, I've got to hold it here, it'll click off first time. Here goes.